This is chapter 28, Wound Management and Bandaging. To understand wound management, we need to understand what are the phases of wound healing. So in normal animals, including people, there are very specific times and a series of events that happen in order to heal wounds. There's the inflammatory, we also call this the lag phase. During the first 3 to 5 days, there are a lot of things being put into place in order for healing to happen. It starts with inflammatory. There's a lag time before healing can actually occur. And what's happening during that time is the clotting cascade. So very immediately, the body wants to stop the bleeding. Then they're going to bring in macrophages. Well, first the neutrophils. Neutrophils are the first ones that come in, and then macrophages. So they're going to come in and take care of any cleanup, any initial cleanup that needs to happen to clean up that wound. Then we have the proliferative phase. This overlaps a little bit with the inflammatory phase. It starts at about 2 to 3 days and can continue for several weeks depending on the size of the wound. And that's where we get our fibroblasts and our growth factors, the parts of the collagen that come in to start making that scar tissue. That's when granulation, we're going to talk about granulation tissue, but that's when granulation and epithelialization occurs. So first we get a nice bed of granulation tissue underneath where the skin is, and then the skin will crawl across it in order to form a new skin barrier over top of that. And that at that point, that's when wound contraction occurs. So that's inflammatory, first 3 to 5 days. And then proliferative, starting at 2 to 3 days and continuing on as needed. Maturation is the part of the wound healing where you have kind of a remodeling, realignment of the collagen fibers where maximum strength occurs. So with the scar tissue, the hair starts growing back in, etc. So for instance, we're looking at this picture. Part A is your inflammatory stage. So this is occurring within the first 3 days or so of the wound. After that, we have this granulation tissue starting in this pinkish part. The more pinky red part of this wound is the underlying tissue that starts the healing process. That's called granulation, and that's part of the proliferative phase. And if you look at part C here, that really pink stuff, that's really healthy granulation tissue, we need that to occur before the skin starts to come in. And if you look around the edges of even B and C, you can see this new skin starting to form over the granulation tissue. That granulation tissue just has lots of really good components, lots of little blood vessels and good components that help to form the skin. The skin cells can grow over top of that. If you look at D, we have the start of maturation. So the granulation tissue is being covered with the skin, the epithelialization. The skin is coming across, and it's starting to contract that wound. Now, if you look at this wound, you'll notice that it is kind of roundish in appearance. Epithelialization happens from the outside in. So if you have a round wound, it will keep getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until you have a little tiny dot, and it will continue to try to fill that dot in, but it's harder to fill in a circle than it is to fill in a line. That's why when we make incisions, we typically make it in line, because the animal will heal from side to side, not end to end, if that makes sense. I do have in your eLearn, I have a story in here just to try to kind of make this a little bit more clear, the process, to help you to remember. It's goofy. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense throughout the whole thing, but this is one way to learn a new thing is to make a story in your head about the process. So tell a little story with some pictures. Tony was playing soccer. He fell down. He boomed. And he skinned his knee and he started to cry, but he looked and he realized it was already starting to heal. Blood was coming up in the wound. It was cleaning it out and was bringing all the inflammatory cells to his skin. So Tony's really happy that that's happening. So he starts to relax because the blood vessels are constricting and the blood flow decreases. So as the blood flows, because we have this injury and then the blood flows, the vessels decrease, the blood starts to slow down. And when the blood slows down, that means that we can get some clotting. Now, then after about 5 to 10 minutes he starts to freak out again. He starts to panic. He knows the blood vessels dilating again and more fluid was leaking out. But that fluid contains clotting elements and inflammatory cells. And so that's how the blood clot is formed. So you have a cut, you get immediate vasoconstriction, and then a little bit of vasodilation. That's to bring in all the good stuff that we can get to form that clot. So the clot's formed, the fibrin in the clot provides minimal wound strength, and we have this inflammatory phase. Okay, so Tony is not very strong and he passes out. A cool scab formed overnight. Okay, so this is formed by that fluid that kind of leaked out of that those blood vessels. It's a serousy fluid that gets crusty. And it protects Tony's knee from all the bacteria that are trying to gain entrance in the body. So it's our body's little bandage. When you look at it closely, because he's got super eyes, he noticed there are white blood cells, neutrophils and monocytes, that are oozing out of the wound and carrying all the necrotic tissue, bacteria, and foreign material with them. He shouts to his friends, "Hey guys, look at my exudate." So he's learning new words. That exudate has the white blood cells. It's got that fluid, the plasma fluid, from that dilated blood vessel that dilated to bring all that inflammatory stuff to the wound. They're gathering around, and they're looking, they're poking and prodding, and they notice the scab doesn't hold together very well. Scott, who, of course, is the doctor's son and knows everything, says, "Tony, man, your wound is only in the lag phase. Wound strength is minimal. Don't pick at it for at least 3 to 5 days or you'll make it bigger." But it's too late because Tony passes out again. When he comes to a couple days later, because he's a real weenie, he looks again at his cool scab and he notices that around the edges there's this pinkish tissue. And he looks again with his super eyes and he notices there's lots of new capillaries coming in. They're bringing fibroblasts. And he says to Scott, he says, "Am I in the repair phase now?" And Scott replies hotly because he's the doctor's son, "Well, I don't know, bud. Do you have any granulation tissue? Graduation issue? Dude, I'm only in the 4th grade. "No," laughs Scott, "granulation tissue. Here's your granulation tissue, and that's what we need to see the repair phase, or the proliferation phase." So what is that? So Scott is explaining to Tony that capillaries and fibroblasts are at a wound, and they're together forming granulation tissue, and that significantly increases wound strength and fills in that tissue defect, protecting the wound, providing barrier to infection, and it's a surface for new skin or epithelial cells and myofibroblasts. "Meyer, what?" whined Tony. "Myofibroblasts. Really cool cells that drag the edges of your wound together, and that's what's called contraction. And that's usually at about 5 to 9 days after the injury." So here we go. We've got myofibroblasts contracting that wound together. And his Tony's starting to wobble a little bit because he's not loving the explanation. What's even cool is that epithelialization is occurring at this time as well. So the skin cells are starting to spread over the wound. "My dad says that you can suture a wound within a few hours. These cells start in 24 to 48 hours. So we have a golden period of about 6 hours that if we can suture that together, those epithelial cells, the epithelialization starts in 2 to 4 days, or 1 to 2 days, I'm sorry, 1 to 2 days, not 5 to 9 days. So don't worry, Tony, you are healing by second intention just fine. That means that he didn't have a first intention or it's not being sutured together. And once the epithelial layers start to build up, the wound will get stronger and start stronger. Unfortunately, it will never be as strong as the skin around it, but the scar shouldn't be too bad. "Nah," said Tony as he woke up the next week, "it doesn't look bad at all." So a little bit of scarring. It's not as strong as the skin around it, but it heals just fine. So just a little story to kind of take you through the stages of wound healing so you understand what is going on during that process. Now, there are a lot of factors that influence wound healing. One of the things is the patient's age, if they have any other orthopedic or neurologic problems, and their nutrition status. Nutrition is a big thing that helps with wound healing. Also, what's going on with the wound? How was the wound formed? And is there any contamination of the wound? And also any concurrent treatment factors. Do we need to cover the wound? Do we need to leave the wound open? Is there medication that we're giving that will reduce the healing of the wound? So some things to remember about wound healing as well is that infection, this is in red, infection stops the progression of wound healing. So red means it stops, right? So infection, if there's any infection going on along in the wound at all, the wound will not heal. Corticosteroids, these are drugs that we might get, or stress, that internal or endogenous corticosteroids, stress will cause this, will delay, so that's yellow, will delay phases of wound healing. We can, if we use proper care, we can eliminate those many wound factors. One other thing to remember is radiation therapy can lead to tissue fibrosis and vascular scarring, both of which negatively affect wound healing. Main things I want you to remember: infection stops wound healing, and corticosteroids delay wound healing. So to manage this, we need to stabilize the wound, prevent contamination, and clean it out and lavage it. The best way to do this is with a saline bag. We can put an administration set onto it, and even better if we can use a syringe to pressurize, and a needle to pressurize the saline, so that we can wash it out with pressure and get all that debris out of there. Debridement. Debridement is when we remove diseased or necrotic tissue or contaminated tissue so that we can help with wound healing. This is a surgical debridement that we're seeing, and it's called en bloc, which is French for we're taking out a big chunk. Okay. We can do it with enzymes. There are certain enzymes we can use that will help to debride wounds. Or mechanically, you can use gauze to help remove necrotic tissue. Maggots can help remove necrotic tissue as well. We can also do a staged debridement where we remove portions at a time to allow healing to occur, but also as things heal and as things get better, we can prevent them from getting worse by doing a staged debridement as well. So we have different types of wound closure that we can do it just depends on the type of wound, to help with wound management, okay? So if we have an incision or a cut that has happened within the last 6 hours, it's a surgery, we can do a primary closure where we close all parts of that wound with sutures. Now, internal sutures need to be absorbable material. External sutures do not need to be absorbable because we can remove those. Secondary closure, let me say this real quick. Open wound management is if we need to leave a wound open because there's an infection still in there, or it's a really big wound and we just need to keep cleaning it out, keep draining it. This is a type of open wound closure where we slowly bring it together, but we leave it open so we can continuously flush it out. And then we can have a secondary closure. So one thing that we can do, this open wound management, the second layer here is allowing the wound to close on its own and just keeping it open. Secondary closure, also known as tertiary intention, is when we have a wound that we allow to start to granulate in, and this nasty picture down here starts to granulate in, and then we may remove a portion of that granulation and then to freshen the edges and get good blood flow, and then close it with a suture just to bring it, help it to heal a little bit faster. So primary would be your surgical wound, just bringing those edges together right away. Open wound management or secondary intention is where we just let it heal on its own, like Tony's knee. And secondary closure or tertiary intention is where we have a wound, we allow it to granulate in a little bit, and then we take out a portion and close it surgically. Wound drainage. We might want to put a drain or some tube or something in the wound if we have a large wound. A large wound, the body does not like dead space and doesn't like infection. So a drain will help us to flush out infection, but also if there is dead space, the body will try to fill it with plasma or serum, and that will cause separation between the tissues and it won't allow it to heal. So we'll put a drain in it. The most common drain we use in veterinary medicine is a passive or Penrose drain. And that just uses capillary action, which means it just drains along the outside of that Penrose drain, that latex tubing. You'll notice that it is next to but not within the incision. So we don't want to put it next to the incision because that needs to heal on its own, or in the incision because it needs to heal on its own, but we can put it next to the incision allow that area to drain. After 3 to 4 days, we're going to take that out because it's open to the environment and bacteria can get into it. So after 3 or 4 days, we take it out and allow it to close. An active drain would be something we would place sterilely, use kind of a closed system, a closed suction system, and vacuum action. It's a more of a rigid fenestrated or windowed drain that we would control the how we drain things out of it. Wound infections. Remember I said this stops progression of healing. Here are some signs. Get a pustular exudate, swelling, redness, pain. We need to determine the severity, and that was going to help us with the choice of antimicrobial. Are we going to give oral versus IV? And also depends on the type of pathogen. So culturing and doing the sensitivity on the organisms is important. And then sometimes we can use topical antimicrobials as well. There are different types of wounds, and knowing the difference between the different types of wounds is really important. An abrasion is just removing the top layer of the epidermis. A laceration is a cut in the skin. Now, lacerations are often caused by blunt trauma. Let me say that again. Lacerations are often caused by blunt trauma. Okay, that means that when you hit skin or something hard enough, it rips apart. And so lacerations aren't usually made by something sharp, by actually something blunt. Okay. A degloving injury is an injury that rips the top layer of the skin off, like the whole skin off. And we see degloving injuries along limbs and also along jaws. Bite wounds can be problems because we have to find each of the wound that got into the skin, but also they can bite down into the skin and the wound will be on the surface, but there will be tissue damage deep into the skin as well. So we have to follow that wound down, flush it out really well. There are burns. Decubitus ulcers are come usually from pressure sores, where we have pressure decreasing capillary movement, blood movement through the dermis, which kills the skin on top of it and causes an ulcer. Maintaining a moist wound environment will actually speed epithelialization and is preferred over allowing the wound to dry out and scab over. So bandaging, we prefer bandaging. Also keeping the wound a little bit warmer than usual is helpful. So here's a degloving injury. That's when a large section of skin is torn off the underlying tissue in kind of a glove-like fashion. This can be cleaned up and sutured back into position with a drain, and it should heal nicely. A bite wound is challenging because they're often more extensive and into the deeper tissue. It's not apparent with the inspection of the skin. If you are seeing 2 bite wounds, you should be looking for more bite wounds. If you see only 1 puncture wound, look for a second one and possibly 2 more. Remember, canines is what we're looking for. Those are the ones that usually penetrate. Burns are classified on the basis of how deep into the tissue the injury reaches and how large the affected area is. When the burn is deep and the skin is completely dead down to the muscle, that is extensive burn. Decubitus ulcers develop over bony prominences as a result of skin compression on hard floors during long periods of recumbency. Here is an example of a decubitus ulcer. Okay, we're going to talk about bandaging now that we've talked about wounds. So why do we use bandages and what are the principles of applying bandages? Bandages are applied to manage soft tissue and to stabilize bone and joint injuries. They consist of 3 layers, okay? There's the adherent primary, which doesn't necessarily mean it's sticking to the wound. All it means is it's contacting the wound. So the primary, adherent primary layer is contacting the wound. The non-adherent primary layer goes outside of the primary layer and provides padding. And the tertiary protective holds and protects the other 2 layers. When we're talking about bandaging small animals, the most common distal limb bandage that we will see is the modified Robert Jones. A Robert Jones bandage is a bandage that is applied with a large amount of padding so that the limb looks like basically like a cylinder. A modified Robert Jones uses less padding. When applying a Robert Jones bandage, the first layer that contacts the wound is typically, so actually let me start by saying this. A is not where we start. A is the second or third layer, okay? Typically, the way we start is by placing a tape stirrup. A tape stirrup is tape that is applied sticky side down on both sides of the leg and comes out beyond the foot, okay? We're going to keep that down here beyond the foot until we get to a certain layer where we can reflect it back up, and those stirrups keep that bandage from slipping down, okay? So it's attached to the skin of the dog and then attached to the bandage to keep it in place. The next thing, if we have an open wound, is we're going to put some type of protective covering over that wound. Typically, it is a Telfa pad or a non-stick bandage. In other cases, it might be a sticky bandage because we may want to pull things off of that wound as we redo the bandages. The next thing that we're going to put, if there's no wound, or if it's something that we're not concerned about, it, anything sticking to it, is we will put cotton padding. This cotton padding will go around the limb from the inside to the outside in the same direction every time you put it on. I'm going to start from the inside of the leg and go around to the outside. And we're going to apply it in a way that is covering, each layer is going to cover about 50% of the next layer, of the next line up, so we don't have any places where we're pulling too tight on in one area. Once that's put on nice and smoothly with no wrinkles, wrinkles are very irritating and can cause some pressure sores. So once that's put on, there's a secondary layer that is a cotton gauze wrap that we'll put on, and we'll keep that cotton padding in place, and we'll put a tertiary layer like Coflex, not too tightly. Again, we don't want to put anything too tightly. We want to see at least two toes out here that we can feel. We want to see some cotton up above here. And we're going from pretty much the top of the leg all the way down. With casts and splints, we're going to use these to provide more stabilization, more rigid support for joint injuries. These are used as typically temporary support until surgery because they're not the best way to provide ongoing support. They can sometimes be used for definitive treatments. If it's a small animal and a small break, we might be able to use that. Or we can use it as an adjunct after surgery. They're only for injuries below the elbow or the stifle. A lot of places can use prefabricated splints. There's a right and a left hand side to these and a front and a back limb. We can also use spica splints, which are the splints that you might see for your finger, just a long kind of ellipsoid space or shape. They're not shaped like the limb, okay? It is important when we are stabilizing a joint or a fracture. We need to stabilize the joint above and the joint below the fracture. So if you have a fracture of your hand, the below your knuckles, of your hand between your wrist and your knuckles, you need to stabilize your knuckles, at least the first joint, if not the second joint of your fingers, and you need to stabilize your wrist. If you have a fracture of your lower arm, your radius or your ulna, you need to stabilize the wrist and the elbow. Okay, so a joint above, a joint below. Slings. There are 5 different slings that you need to know the difference. The Aimer sling. The Aimer sling is this first one. It says an Aimer sling is shown in place. This is for a back leg only. This Aimer sling just is a figure eight around the back leg to try to keep that toe off the ground. It is for maintaining no weight on that hip. No weight on these joints, basically, but no weight specifically on that hip. A 90-90 flexion is similar to the Aimer sling, but it's a little bit more rigid in that there's a figure eight and then there's a loop that goes around that figure eight to keep it in place. As you can see, that sometimes this Amer sling will slip off that knee. Okay. The Velpo sling is for the front limb. The Velpo is for the shoulder, to keep the shoulder, any pressure for being on the shoulder. And basically you're wrapping the front limb up against the body. The carpal flexion is just for the carpus, but if you wrap that carpus in flexion, the animal will not be able to use that limb and put pressure on the elbow or the shoulder. So they can walk three-legged with the Velpo or the carpal, or the Amer or the 90-90 flexion slings. So the Amer and 90-90 flexion are for the hips, the Velpo and the carpal flexion are for the shoulders. The hobbles are used, it can be used in the front or the rear, more typically used in the rear, to keep the legs from abducting. We want to keep the legs from splaying out, and it protects the hips and the spine. So here's the Amer sling going around the thigh and around the tarsus to keep the leg up and any pressure from being on that hip. Some bandages for other locations. We can do a tie-over bandage. This is in the axillary region of an animal, the armpit region, basically. Very difficult to bandage in there. Placing a bandage in there and then suturing over top of it will keep the bandage in place. We could use an adhesive drape like we would use for surgery. We can use a three-layer soft padded bandage on specific distal limbs or in different areas. It's similar to a Robert Jones, but doesn't go the entire way up the leg. Bandages around the chest can be done. It can't be too tight. You have to be careful. Around the abdomen, we can do it. Tail bandages are typically hard to keep in place because of those wagging tails, but there are ways to do it as well. Wound management aftercare. It's really important that you educate the client. So timing is really important. We have to be very careful not to do prolonged immobilization. We need to keep those joints moving. We need to make sure we're doing regular bandage changes. If the bandage gets wet at all, even if it dries, it will still be wet next to the skin, and we have to change that bandage. If we're not changing it because it's wet, we should be changing it every 3 to 4 days. Limiting exercise, so we keep the bandage in place. Monitoring those distal limb bandages so that they're not chewing at it and that they don't get any swelling because it's too tight. We can use protective devices, so Elizabethan collars to keep them from licking or chewing it. Plastic bags when they go outside to keep it from getting wet with the dewy grass, or even if it's not raining, it can be dewy in the morning and at night. So complications can be too tight, too wet, they're licking or chewing. And it's really important to educate the clients about this. Large animal wound management, wound care on horses. Typically when we do wound care on horses, it's a lot of cleanup and we do more local versus general anesthesia, a lot more preparing of the wound. This is an example of how to give lidocaine injection around a wound so that we can suture it without general anesthesia. One thing about horses that is different, they get exuberant granulation tissue. It's also known as proud flesh. Basically, they really like to granulate tissue. They are very over-exuberant about granulating in wounds. To control it, we can immobilize the limb, put a pressure bandage around it, not too tight because we can't limit blood flow. Immobilize the limb. Do a wound bandage. We can do cryotherapy, which is burning the tissue up, or electrocautery. There are certain powdered, like desiccants or drying agents, that can help to limit granulation tissue as well. Bandage application for horses. We do it for lower limb wounds or just for lower limb support. This is an example of a bandage that might be applied to a horse that would be traveling in a trailer for a long period of time just to support those tendons. We apply the bandage very much like we would do a Robert Jones, where we're not doing it too tightly. We're applying it so that we're doing 50% of the bandage is on the last one that was put down so that there's no tight spaces. It's nice and even, not a lot, no wrinkles. There's a couple of wrinkles there. You want to be careful with that, but no wrinkles down here. Lower limb bandage. First, we're going to apply this non-adherent dressing and then some conforming gauze and make sure that we're going proximal and distal to any wound edges, so above and below, so it's not rubbing on the wound edges. With horses, it does take some time to apply bandages. They tend to be used to having their legs messed with, and so it's not hard to get them to lay still. But there's a lot of different things we might need. So rolled cotton, there's a lot of different types of rolled cotton here. Layered cotton sheets, quilted leg wraps. This is a quilted leg wrap. You can use a military field bandage, which is J here. And then some outer Coflex and gauze bands and that kind of thing. The outer shell can be elastic wrap or elastic tape, an ACE bandage or track wrap or wrap tape around the bandage, and we use kind of that barber pole fashion, again, covering 50% of the layer laid down below it. Just some pictures showing we are going to teach you how to apply this. I guess the important thing to remember is to not do it too tightly, to make sure there are no wrinkles, and to do it nice and evenly. Splint application, if we have an extensor or flexor tendon laceration or any flexor deformities in foals, we may have to apply a splint to a horse. This is a PVC pipe that has been cut down so that it goes around the hoof and it's applied with duct tape. With casts for cattle or claw blocks for cattle, remember, we talked a little bit about some foot rot for them and the need to trim that off. We would have put a claw block on to keep that affected injured claw off the ground. So gluing that in place. A modified Thomas splint. So I just want you to remember that larger animals need larger splints. And so this one is made up of a metal ring and flex that we start by making some flexible tubing to make a circle, and then we bend the metal to go in the form of that tubing, and we fit that around the leg, the first part of the leg, and then bend that, pat it with cotton so it's comfortable. But this is an example of a modified Thomas splint on a cattle, and then a casting goes around that splint, and everything is kept in space in place so that they can't move that leg too much. So also has a foot plate that they walk on, and that's actually sutured or drilled. There's something is drilled into the calf's hoof, and it's wired into place. So just some more information about the modified Thomas splint. I guess my biggest thing about that is to remember what it's called when you see one, that's a modified Thomas splint. So if you have any questions, let me know. Primarily want to know about the phases of wound healing, what helps with wound healing, what hurts with wound healing, what are the different kinds of incisions that you can that can be healed, how they're healed, how long it takes, how it's best healed, and then some of those more common bandages and slings that we use.